Hello, the historian Edward Gibbon wrote, "Every age, however destitute of science or virtue, sufficiently abounds with acts of blood and military renown. War, it seems, is one of mankind's most constant companions, one that has blighted the lives and troubled the minds of men and women from antiquity onwards. Plato envisioned a society without war, but found it had no arts, no culture, and no political system. War was often thought as desirable. It's peace which is now desirable. But how has war been understood through the ages? Who has it served, and how has it been justified? Is war inherent to human beings, or could society be organized to the exclusion of all conflict? With me to discuss the thought and history of war are Sir Michael Howard, Emeritus Professor of Modern History at the University of Oxford, Angie Hobbs, Lecturer in Philosophy at the University of Warwick, and Jeremy Black, Professor of History at the University of Exeter. Angie Hobbs, war featured greatly in Greek life. In a sense, the foundation of our literature is the great war book, Iliad. Can you just say what Homer said in around 800 BC about war in that book?
Yes. Right from the very beginning, we're presented with a very complex picture of war. On the one hand, war seems to be accepted not simply as an inevitable facet of human experience, but also as the ideal training ground, display case, and test for heroic courage. The supreme Greek warrior Achilles makes it explicit that his brand of heroism requires a battlefield. And battlefields, of course, are also where the hero wins the glory that is to be his compensation for risking his life or even sacrificing his life. The danger of this approach, of course, is that it could lead some people, not Homer, I think, but some of his readers, to approve of war or even actively to promote it. And the test case here might be the warrior leader Alexander the Great, who absolutely hero-worshipped Achilles and devoted his brief life to seek out war and conquest in an explicit attempt to emulate and even to supersede his hero. On the other hand, Homer is absolutely unflinching in his depiction of the suffering, pity, and waste of war, as exemplified in his extraordinarily moving scene between Achilles and the Trojan king Priam. Priam comes to Achilles' tent as a supplicant to request the return of the body of Priam's son Hector, whom Achilles has slain and whose corpse he has defiled. And Achilles is so moved by Priam's courage and grief that he is briefly moved to reflect on what he is doing in Troy and what he is doing causing sorrow to the Trojan people, as he puts it. So right from the beginning, you get this complexity.
And we have the dark side, because we have Achilles' bloodlust. What's the Greek word for it?
That's right, kame, yes.
Kame, and bloodlust, yes. And the slaughtering of these boys to sacrifice with his friend Patroclus, who's been killed. Homer seems to disapprove of that, even though, as it were, he's a Homer hero.
Oh, yes, yes. I mean, some of the acts committed by Homeric heroes, particularly by Achilles, are clearly castigated by other characters and gods in the Iliad itself. It's not an uncomplicated picture by any means.
Have you any means of judging how far this was a reflection of the actual experience of Greeks at the time? Not so much in the battles, we need to go into the details of that, but the idea that these were the great virtues, the heroic virtues, the virtues of courage, and these could be tested, these were the greatest things to do, and these could only be tested on battlefields.
Yes, well, if you take Euripides, for instance, Euripides will tend to look at the innocent victims of war, as depicted, for instance, in his play The Trojan Women, where he looks at the conquered and soon to be enslaved Trojan women. And he makes it clear that these victims, or at least it's a suggestion that these victims don't just represent all innocent victims of war, but are specifically representative of the inhabitants of the island of Melos, whom the Athenians had treated with the utmost savagery and cruelty very recently. So there you get a direct example of how the interaction between Greek literature and Greek experience.
Very briefly, when Plato tried to think about a world without war through Socrates, he found it was a world without anything else as well, didn't he?
Yes, that's right.
No science, no culture.
That's right. I mean, yeah, Plato's particularly interesting in that he tries to examine the origins of warfare and whether it's an evitable or inevitable aspect of human experience. And his character Socrates in the Republic, when he's setting up his model of the ideally just state, he initially postulates a pre-politicized and pre-monetary community of just one class of individuals who are both producers and consumers of very basic goods and who live a very simple, harmonious and ascetic life. And the crucial point here is that they live a life at peace, both amongst themselves and with their neighboring states. But one of Socrates' interlocutors protests that a life of such simple pleasures is too basic. It's a society fit only for pigs, as he puts it. And so Socrates is forced to introduce more sophisticated activities and pleasures and what he terms the unnecessary desires. Now, the problem here is that these unnecessary desires are limitless. So as soon as they're introduced, there is a move to expansion and to the appropriation of the goods and territory of neighbouring states, and hence the instantiation of war and the need for a military class.
So, Michael Howard, in your reading, you think that the Greeks took it for granted that they would go to war, that they lived in a state in which war was simply part of the nature of life. And is this reflected in their organisation of the Athenian army, the citizen army?
It was certainly, I speak as a total non-expert as that, but it was certainly taken for granted as part of the nature of human life. There's an element to be introduced, which hasn't been discussed, which is the gods, that one was at the mercy of these totally capricious gods who are in a state of war with themselves as often as not, and there was really nothing that you could do about it. It had to be accepted that the nature of life was tragic. Or it was comic, but certainly underlying there was this problem of tragedy which one had to come to terms with. And the hero was somebody who defied the gods, who accepted that his fate was going to be tragic, and that one measured people's virtue by the capacity with which they were able to stand up to this tragedy and overcome it, make a good end. One was going to die anyway. One might as well die fighting the gods, but certainly die fighting.
And one of the gods was a god of war, wasn't he?
One of the gods was a god of war, but they were all of them pretty bellicose.
What can you tell us about the Greek, the Athenian citizen army, and how significant do you think that was?
Again, I speak subject to correction on this. But it was a criterion of a free man that he fought. Those who did not fight were women and slaves and children. That it was part of the duty and the honour and the virtue of men that they did fight for their state, and therefore the citizen was automatically a soldier, and soldiers were automatically citizens.
So you had a potent combination of sort of the freedom to do this, the manhood fighting for the state, all combined in one thing in the war. So it became very complicated from the beginning, didn't it?
I'd say it came very simple. It was really simple from the beginning. That if you were a free man. And not a slave, automatically you were a warrior. And it really was as simple as that. There was something very odd about somebody who was not a warrior.
Can I just persist with some trepidation on this, Michael? But if you're bringing in ideas of manhood, freedom, fighting for your own city into one act, isn't that rather putting a lot of complicated things into one box? I'm just about to duck for you. We are straight left again this
time.
Well,
we have complicated it. The situation has become a great deal more complex since then. But at that time, I would have thought that it was seen as very, very simple indeed. Am I wrong on that one?
Well, can I just persist with, ask me one more question? The Roman army became a professional army. Was that even more professional than the Spartan army had been? Because they were still a citizens' army, weren't they, the Spartan army, to a certain extent? So what was the big change with the Roman army?
I'm out of my depth here.
What was the big change with the Roman army?
Well, the big change of the Roman army was that they were not simply fighting for the defence of Rome and its environment, that as their power increased, it became impossible for a citizen to be...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.